In this video, you will learn how to add and subtract complex numbers. But that is not all, because addition is our first basic transformation. In this series, we are going to visually explore complex functions, so that you can build your own visual intuition about how they transform and behave. Let's begin by looking at the algebra of addition. Addition and subtraction work exactly as you would expect with normal algebra, treating I as a simple constant. Let's take, for example, 3 plus 2i plus 2 plus i. Firstly, we add the real parts, 3 plus 2 is 5. Then we add the imaginary parts, 2i plus i is 3i. Now let's take a look on the complex plane. We start at our first number, 3 plus 2i. Then go an additional 2 units in the real direction and 1 unit in the imaginary direction. You can also think of the numbers as vectors. Just place the arrows end to end. If you're familiar with vector addition for linear algebra, the process is exactly the same. In fact, the complex numbers qualify as a vector space. Okay, let's try one more. Minus 2 plus 3i plus 7 minus 6i equals 5 minus 3i. Visually, we start at minus 2 plus 3i. Then, our spot transforms 7 units to the right and 6 units down. Subtraction is simply the inverse of addition, and algebraically it is also calculated as you would expect. 3 plus 2i minus 2 plus i equals 1 plus i. For visualizing subtraction, it can be useful to think of adding the negative of the value. So we can think of adding minus 2 minus i onto 3 plus 2i. Subtraction is commonly used to find the distance between two points. The points 3 plus 2i and 2 plus i are separated by one real unit and one imaginary unit, or 1 plus i. We can then use Pythagoras' theorem to work out the absolute value of 1 plus i, which is root 2. This is the distance between our two points. For all we gain with complex numbers, we do lose something by moving to the complex domain. Which number is greater, 2 plus 3i or 3 plus 2i? There is no useful comparison. The concepts of greater and less than don't work in the complex plane. The complex numbers are unordered. It can be useful to compare the absolute value of numbers, that is, the distance from the origin. But this is only a real number. The complex numbers themselves can't be put in a useful order. For our functions, addition and subtraction represent a translation. Let's again plot many points on our plane. Now let's add 1 plus i to every point. All the points are then shifted in the direction of 1 plus i. This now represents the function z plus 1 plus i. It is equivalent to think of this as moving the coordinate system. Mathematicians and physicists often like to think this way. We can perform the same visualization, but keep our camera focused on our spots and move the coordinate axis instead. The result is exactly the same as before, but we are just looking from a different viewpoint. It often simplifies physical problems to pick a suitable point for the origin. For example, if you are studying the orbit of a satellite traveling around the Earth, you may wish to shift your coordinates so that the origin is at the center of the Earth. Or perhaps setting the origin at a ground-based satellite dish is more useful. It's time to practice using our visualization tools again. Remember, the color we are looking at is the angle of the output. Let's add 1 plus i to our function z. Notice that the point where the colors meet moves. This is where the function equals 0. In fact, for all well-behaved functions, which we will call analytic, we find zeros where all the colors meet. Anytime you see a meeting of colors in the correct rotational order, you know that the value is 0. Let's move into 3D now. Plotting the absolute value of our output on the vertical axis, this is the function f of z equals z, as we saw in the last video. Let's now add 1 plus I to the function. We can see that the 0 has moved to the point minus 1 minus I. This animation may in fact be a little deceptive. Things aren't moving laterally over the plane, they are instead moving up. I'll replay the animation. If you look at any red point, which is already positive, you can see that it moves upwards. It moves upwards by a distance of root 2. What we can see clearly now with this graphic is the position where our function is equal to 0, minus 1, minus I. All the colours also meet at this point. Let's plot z squared as a 3D phase portrait. You can see that there is a 0 at the origin. What will happen if we add 1 to this equation? A quick look at the real graph shows that z squared plus 1 equals 0 has no real solutions. The line does not cross the x-axis. The equation z squared plus 1 in the complex plane, however, has two zeros. They are on the imaginary axis at plus or minus I. There are no real solutions. This tells us that we can factorise z squared plus 1 as z minus I, z plus I. Actually, we don't need to be in 3D to find these solutions. If we look at the 2D phase portrait for z squared plus 1, we find the zeros at the points where the colours meet. Notice how the phase portrait is red along the real axis. This indicates that the output along this axis is real and positive. Watch what happens when we add or subtract different constants from z squared. For the function z squared minus 4, we can see that the real axis is cyan between the points plus or minus 2, indicating that the output is real and negative. We can see the zeros at plus or minus 2. A degree 2 polynomial always has two roots on the complex plane. In fact, this is true of any polynomial. A degree n polynomial has n roots on the complex plane. A result known as the fundamental theorem of algebra. Sometimes these roots may be in the same place, such as the function z squared. In this case, we can still see the double root on our phase portrait. The colours meet at 0 twice, indicating a double root. Notice that the colours are still in the same rotational order though. Naturally, the fundamental theorem of algebra extends to all polynomials. For example, the function z to the power of 7 has a multiplicity of 7. The colours meet 7 times at the point z equals 0. For the function z to the power of 7 plus 1, we can see clearly that there are 7 points on the complex plane that are equal to 0. The complex plane gives a full and complete picture of a polynomial. It gives a visual and geometric meaning to the algebra. Notice how we can still see most of the important information of this function in 2D alone. Once you learn to read phase portraits, they can convey a surprisingly large amount of information. Before we finish up this video, let's try adding some simple constants to another function that we are becoming familiar with, the cosine of z. On the 2D phase portrait, we can again read the zeros off quite easily, spread at 2π intervals along the real axis. Adding 1 to this function raises it up. Let's try animating this in 3D. Watch how the graph changes as we raise it from cos of z to cos of z plus 1. On the real line, cos of z is never greater than 1. But what will happen if we try the function cos of z plus 2? Are there any points where cos of z plus 2 equals 0? In fact, we can see that there are, but we find no solutions on the real number line. If you watched the last video, it's probably no surprise that the solutions can be expressed in a way that involves the hyperbolic functions. But that is a little deeper than I want to go in this video. That's it for this video. The main takeaway is that addition and subtraction move functions on the complex plane. They are a translation. You will notice that I'm quite deliberately leading you down the path of thinking about functions as maps or transformations. This is because it's quite often useful to transform a difficult problem into an easier one. The beauty of complex numbers is that they are very good tools for making such transformations. In the next video, we will be exploring polar coordinates, and we will come across one of the coolest formulas in mathematics, Euler's identity.